Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And we're now just in the early lessons of a new series entitled The Holy Spirit and Spirituality. This particular lesson itself is entitled The Holy Spirit Working Behind the Scenes. Think about the implications of that. This is lesson number 2 in that series for January 14 of 2017. Before we jump into the lesson, we'd like to ask you to bow your heads with us as we ask the Holy Spirit to guide us in our study. Our kind and wonderful Father, we want to thank you first of all for the work which has been done by the Holy Spirit and the work which continues to be done by the Holy Spirit. May it guide us in our discussion here today. And may we come to know you better through that very important work as our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. It should be pretty clear, I think, to every, it should be, no, I'm emphasizing should be, to every Bible reading, Bible studying, Bible believing Christian, and we probably ought to throw the Jews in there as well, for at least part of scriptures, that the focus of the Holy Scriptures is on Jesus Christ and His Father. Now, of course, the Jews would leave Jesus out of this. The Holy Spirit always plays a supporting role. However, that's not an insignificant role. He was there at creation, we know, Genesis 1:1-2. He sustained Jesus from His birth, even before His birth and throughout His ministry. However, unless we search carefully, we may know very little about the Holy Spirit. We have a hard time understanding the role of the Holy Spirit, probably because He works so quietly and unselfishly behind the scenes, our natural selfishness cannot really understand that kind of behavior. Well, okay, let's look at some passages that give us some clues. Look at John 3:3-8. Now here's an experience. Remember that Nicodemus came to Jesus quietly at night without letting anybody know what he has in mind, and he's asking some questions. And Jesus answers, "I am telling you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God without being born again." And Nicodemus, I'm sure, is going, "Huh? How can a grown man be born again?" Nicodemus asked. "He certainly cannot enter his mother's womb and be born a second time." "I'm telling you the truth," replied Jesus. "No one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. A person is born physically of human parents, but is born spiritually of the Spirit. Do not be surprised because I tell you that you must all be born again. The wind blows wherever it wishes. You hear the sound it makes, but you do not know where it comes from or where it is going. It is like that with everyone who is born of the Spirit." What are the implications of that?
Nicodemus went right to the natural explanation.
You know? Yeah.
How does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Because he was thinking only as a natural man.
Well, there's a very interesting chapter in the Old Testament found in Ezekiel 37 that talks a little bit about what the Spirit can do. I'm just going to read verse 5 and verse 9. This is a story of the Holy Spirit showing up, Ezekiel showing up, and God says, "Watch this," and there's a whole valley full of dry bones. And these bones come together, they reconnect, they get covered with muscles, and bingo, there's a whole bunch of people, live people. And this is what God says about them. "Tell them that I, the Sovereign Lord, am saying to them, I'm going to put breath into you and bring you back to life." And verse 9, "God said to me, mortal man, prophesy to the wind." And what's another word for wind?
Spirit.
Spirit. "Tell the wind that the Sovereign Lord commands it to come from every direction to breathe into these dead bodies and bring them back to life." Okay, so one of the things we want to say right up front so that we understand differences in different translations is the same word. In the Old Testament, it's the word ruach. In the New Testament, it's the word pneuma. It means wind. It means spirit. It means breath. The same word can be translated in all three of those ways. So it could become confusing when you read a passage. We can't see the wind, we can't see the breath, we can't see the Spirit. We may be baffled by the way the Spirit works or the wind works, but we certainly can see its power. I had a patient who came to me just a couple days ago, and he was down in the coast. He has a place down there, actually, a coast place right just off the coast in Florida, went through the last hurricane. Unfortunately for him, his house is about two blocks back from the coast, and so it wasn't seriously damaged, but he was there in the midst of it, and you could certainly tell what the wind did in that case. Well, the Holy Spirit is described as giving life to the lifeless. That life-giving power places him firmly in the Trinity as a member of the Godhead. Why do we say that?
I have no idea.
Who has the power to give life?
The Creator.
Which is who?
You tell me.
God.
Is there anybody beside God who can do that?
No.
So why do you think that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit working together have chosen to keep the work of the Spirit so quiet, sort of behind the scenes?
Well, that's the nature. The Father dwells on a throne high and lifted up and light unapproachable, and Jesus is Emmanuel. He's God with us. He works with us face to face, and the Spirit works within us. So he's sort of the God within when we're born again. But part of their nature is to emphasize the other. So the Father says, here's my beloved Son, hear ye him. The Son says, I can do nothing except I see what I see the Father doing. He talks about the Spirit, but he's going to take of mine and give it to you. He won't talk about himself. So Jesus pretty much lays it out.
Yeah. In the Book of Education, Ellen White on page 170, paragraph 2 says, the mysteries of the Bible, that would be the parts that are a little bit difficult for us to understand, so far from being an argument against it, are among the strongest evidences of its divine inspiration. If it contained no account of God but that which we could comprehend, if his greatness and majesty could be grasped by finite minds, then the Bible would not, as now, bear the unmistakable evidences of divinity. So God says, there's a few things that you don't understand yet. What a surprise.
So why do you put that together with what we just talked about? That I don't quite understand.
Well, let me read you some verses. Genesis 1, 1 and 2. In the beginning, when God created the universe, the earth was formless and desolate. The raging ocean that covered everything was engulfed in total darkness, and the Spirit of God was moving over the water. What does that tell us? Well, you know, it goes on to describe step by step how he created our world. So who was involved? Well, let's give some other verses. Look at Colossians 1, 16 and 17. For through him, this is through Christ he's talking about, the Son, God created everything in heaven and on earth, the seen and the unseen things, including spiritual powers, lords, rulers, and authorities. God created the whole universe through him and for him. Christ existed before all things, and in union with him, all things have their proper place. And we know the very familiar passage in John 1, verses 1 to 3. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. From the very beginning, the Word was with God. Through him, God made all things. Not one thing in all creation was made without him. Okay? So, who was involved?
God.
Who does that involve?
Father, God. Son, Holy Spirit.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Full cooperation. And there's lots of other verses. Job 26, 13, 33, 4, verse 4. Maybe let's look at Job 26, 13. It is his breath that made the sky clear, that would be his Spirit, and his hand that killed the escaping monster. There's that's something to do with ancient mysticism. Well, when it talks about the Spirit hovering over the waters, at the time of creation. What do you think that implies?
God.
Yes, God doing what? Just ignoring the earth, or
no,
does he have something to do here?
It says that he's the creator. That
okay.
In the beginning he created the heavens and the earth, and his spirit was hovering over the water.
Spirit of God.
Yeah.
Spirit of God. Yeah.
I don't know if that excludes. It could mean that all three of them were there.
Yeah. We should be exceedingly grateful that the Holy Spirit was not only active at the creation in the beginning, but also is fully active in recreation in our lives today. So the question is, did it require more creative power to produce the world as it was back in the beginning? Or does it take more creative power to try to redo us after we mess things up?
Or is that Genesis account a story of recreation because of the war in heaven implied with Genesis 1:1, where it says, in beginning he created Elohim, the heavens and the earth, and the earth became a chaos. And so then the rest of Genesis chapter 1 is a story of recreation to answer the questions on the part of the heavenly intelligences that need to see what happened and how he's going to win the rest of his creation over to his side.
Yeah. Well, let's think of some other. Go ahead.
Well, in the old creation, which is now condemned and is dying and waxing old, he starts with the big stuff and then finishes with man. In the new creation, he starts with man. We are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. And as we identify with him in his death and his resurrection, we are part of that new creation, and then he makes the big stuff later. So mm-hmm. there's this, Jesus becomes sort of the portal from the old to the new, and we are taken with him.
But what was the purpose of this earth's creation? Wasn't it not to answer the questions that the onlooking universe had, the Elohim?
Yeah.
If the war in heaven, where do we put that in? Did it happen before the creation of this earth, or was it after? Because
it has to be before, because what it says in Revelation.
Yeah.
Does Ellen White say that because he wasn't taken into the councils that it began to work on him?
She says that it was in the process. The Father and the Son were starting to talk about creating this earth, and then Satan became jealous because he wasn't included.
Right.
But the fact that he was here when the tree of knowledge of good and evil, by the time God had created the Garden of Eden, suggests that the war in heaven had happened and finished, at least the initial part of it, before really the Garden of Eden was created anyway.
It's not illogical that the reason for the earth that we are living, this blue ball that we're living on, was created, that recreated, I would say, in order to answer the questions of the heavenly intelligences, because the adversary in Revelation 12 has convinced a third of them to leave with him. Mm-hmm. And God didn't want to lose the other two-thirds, so he has to teach them. God is a teacher and not a penalty payer. We've got a false paradigm that we've been perpetuating for thousands of years.
One of the things that the Holy Spirit did was help the children of Israel create that beautiful sanctuary that they made at the foot of Mount Sinai. I read, the Lord said to Moses, I have chosen Bezalel, the son of Uri and grandson of Hur, from the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with my power, that could be also my spirit. I have given him understanding, skill, and ability for every kind of artistic work, for planning skillful designs and working them in gold, silver, and bronze, for cutting jewels to be set, for carving wood, and for every other kind of artistic work. And then he talks about Aholiab and so forth. It sounds like the Holy Spirit is involved in making all everything that's beautiful, huh? And it says in Exodus 25, verse 8, the people must make a sacred tent for me so that I may live among them. Make it and all its furnishings according to the plan that I will show you.
We made a statement there that God, the Holy Spirit, is involved in making everything that is beautiful. But we read Genesis 1, that the earth was a chaos, was a mess. Mm-hmm. Would it be more logical that he created it beautiful and then the evil perpetuated and promulgated by the adversary and his minions made a mess out of the place, and God has to teach them how things really work?
Well, it is true that wasn't Satan thrown to earth? Mm-hmm. And then Ellen White said that quickly they moved on to start creating the earth after that happened. Yeah. So, you know, what you say fits, but...
And it doesn't make God look bad, does it? What I just said?
No.
Oh? It's in harmony with everything he wants to do. He wants harmony in his universe. But he's hit his love, which means you have to have the opportunity to make wrong decisions, which are deadly.
Do you think the Holy Spirit is ready to work with us, using our talents to further the kingdom of God? I mean, wasn't that the goal?
Sure.
It's quite clear that the Holy Spirit is not mentioned as frequently in the Old Testament scriptures as he is in the New. Following Pentecost, his work was intensified. So now we have a challenge. Who was the God of the Old Testament?
Jesus.
Mm-hmm. You people have all been corrupted by reading your scriptures very carefully. If you asked a Jewish scholar, who was the God of the Old Testament, what would he say?
Yahweh.
Or he would understand.
Say something. He wouldn't say the word.
No, he wouldn't say it. He wouldn't pronounce the word. That's mm-hmm. correct.
Are you going to quote where we get that it was Jesus?
Well, yeah, I am. 1 Corinthians, the one obvious place is 1 Corinthians 10, verses 1 to 4. We'll get there in a moment, so hold on to that. If they had been willing to accept Christ's words, we say, the disciples should have been prepared for what happened on crucifixion weekend, and we've already, we looked at that last week. Look at these words. Christ took the 12 disciples aside and said to them, listen. Now this is, they are walking from Jericho up that steep hill to Jerusalem. Okay? This is on their way to what's going to be the crucifixion, that final week. We are going to Jerusalem where everything the prophets wrote about the Son of Man will come true. He will be handed over to the Gentiles who will mock him, insult him, and spit on him. They will whip him and kill him, but 3 days later he will rise to life. Now, are there any 15-syllable words in there? No. Are they all? Is there any single word in there that's difficult to understand by itself? No. But the disciples did not understand any of these things. The meaning of the words was hidden from them, and they did not know what Jesus was talking about. Why is that?
Preconceived ideas.
Preconceived ideas.
That came from their worship of God with a false knowledge of God, therefore a false conclusion on the message of God.
On the following Thursday night, the night before he's tried and crucified and all that, he finally had to say to them in John 16, 12, I have much more to tell you, but now it will be too much for you to bear. What is he saying?
You're not ready, guys.
It is our pride that makes it hard for us to join the Holy Spirit in his work. This is some interesting words from J.L. Packer. The Spirit's message to us is never, look at me, listen to me, come to me, get to know me, but always look at him. See his glory, listen to him and bear his words, go to him and have life, get to know him and taste his gift of joy and peace. The Spirit, we might say, is the matchmaker, the celestial marriage broker whose role it is to bring us and Christ together and ensure that we stay together. Let us notice very clearly that the work of the Spirit is always to promote our understanding and cooperation with the Spirit of Christ. That's why we're called Christians and not Numians. What's a Numian? That would be a follower of the Spirit or the Pneuma instead of the Christ or Christian. Well, consider some of the ways in which the Holy Spirit was involved in the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. Now, here's a good one for all you experts on physiology and all those other good things. Mary, an angel appears, or a being appears to Mary. She says to this angel, this mystical person, "I am a virgin. How then can this be? How can I have a baby?" The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and God's power rest upon you. For this reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God." What happened there? Did the Holy Spirit somehow or other take Jesus and sort of...
It's a mystery.
It's a mystery. We clearly don't have any idea how
it happened. A natural explanation. Yeah. We have nothing to compare it with.
Yeah,
but a lot of things are mysteries that way. The burning bush was just as much of a mystery. Jesus appearing to Cain is a mystery. The way he appeared later on to Abraham, isn't that a mystery?
Yeah.
How about the still small voice? That's still a mystery.
Yep.
In the column of smoke and the by day and the fire by night.
The manna.
Look at Luke 3:21-22. What's happening here? After all the people had been baptized, Jesus also was baptized. While he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit came down upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my own dear son, I am pleased with you." Okay, who was involved there? Well, the son's obviously there. The Holy Spirit's obviously there. Is the Father there?
Calls him his son.
So at the very beginning of Christ's ministry, we have what? The Trinity, all present, blessing things, starting out together, right? Well.
And they would always be together because they are one.
There's some very interesting verses. Look at Mark 1, verse 12. "At once the Spirit made him go into the desert, where he stayed 40 days being tempted by Satan." Did the Holy Spirit lead Jesus up to the... Look at Matthew 4, verse 1. "Then the Spirit led Jesus into the desert to be tempted by the devil." Is that God saying, "Okay, Satan, here's your chance"? Luke 4, "Jesus returned from the Jordan full of the Holy Spirit and was led by the Spirit into the desert, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. And all that time he ate nothing." So what's going on there? Did the Holy Spirit intentionally lead Jesus out into the wilderness for the purpose of being tempted by the devil?
No.
So what's it saying here? What was really happening out there?
Christ was strengthening his resolve.
He was preparing himself mentally and spiritually for his ministry. And the Holy Spirit led him out there to do that. So how does Satan come into the picture?
He's drawn to the situation. This is a very important situation. He's not just walking down the road. He's preparing. This is the time to try to hit him when he's...
Put myself into these stories I read in the Bible. Try to imagine yourself in the counsels of Satan as Jesus is out there in the wilderness fasting. What do you think is going on in the counsels of Satan?
Physically, he's getting weaker. I'll wait until he's as weak as he can be, and then I'll hit him.
And Satan is so proud and so self-conceited that he has to go do it himself. He's not going to let anybody else do this job. By the way, was this the first time Jesus and Satan have been face-to-face in a battle?
War in heaven.
There was war in heaven. Can you think of another time?
Counsel in heaven about Job.
The councils in heaven about Job?
raising Moses from the dead.
Right. They fought over the body of Moses. Okay, there's at least three times in the Old Testament, and who won all three of those times?
Jesus.
But in the New Testament, this is the first account we have of an encounter between Jesus and the devil. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very important, because it would almost seem that, as it was with Job, God did not allow Satan to have a great deal of influence or power over him up until that particular moment. Mm-hmm. I mean, he could have been killed when he was just a baby.
Yeah. Well, Herod tried, didn't he?
Sure did.
But the devil tried through Herod.
Yes.
Yeah, well,
the what was convincing, or was matter being convinced or persuaded on the part of Jesus, used words in the battle. Mm-hmm. It wasn't physical. Wasn't the issue. It was purely logic.
Look at a few passages here. Look at Luke 24, starting with verse 44 up to 49. Then he said to them, "This is Jesus, of course, keeping himself, well, he actually has kept himself hidden to the two men on the way to Emmaus, and now they're back in Jerusalem. He's speaking to the disciples. Then he said to them, "These are the very things I told you about while I was still with you, everything written about me in the law of Moses, the writings of the prophets, and the Psalms had to come true." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. What do you think that means?
He taught them.
He did
it logically and methodically, took them through the scriptures and interpreted them to them.
1 week earlier, he hadn't been able to teach them that he was about to be crucified.
Yeah.
What's changed?
Well, it was a rather traumatic experience that they went through. And
they were humbled.
Yeah.
Their spirits were crushed, so they mm-hmm. knew that...
They were forced to take a different look at things. And he said to them, "This is what is written, the Messiah must suffer and must rise from death 3 days later." Now they knew what that meant. "And in his name, the message about repentance and forgiveness of sins must be preached to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and I myself will send unto you what my Father has promised. But you must wait in the city until the power from above comes down upon you." And of course, that was Pentecost. Look at in that context, what happens? Look at Galatians 5, starting with verse 16. Paul writing, "What I say is this, let the Spirit direct your lives, and you will not satisfy the desires of the human nature. For what our human nature wants is opposed to what the Spirit wants, and what the Spirit wants is opposed to what our human nature wants. These two are enemies, and this means that you cannot do what you want to do. If the Spirit leads you, then you are not subject to the law. What human nature does is quite plain. It shows itself in immoral, filthy, indecent actions, in worship of idols and witchcraft. People become enemies and they fight. They become jealous, angry, and ambitious. They separate into parties and groups. They are envious, get drunk, have orgies, and do other things like these. I warn you now as I have before, those who do these things will not possess the kingdom of God. But the Spirit produces love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, and self-control. There is no law against such things as these." So, and Ephesians 4, 23 and 24, "Your hearts and minds must be made completely new, and you must put on the new self, which is created in God's likeness and reveals itself in the true life that is upright and holy." So, in brief now, we're going to try to summarize at least some of the things that the Holy Spirit does. He glorifies Jesus in at least the following ways. One, by teaching about him, that's about Christ, in the Holy Scriptures in a trustworthy and reliable manner. Nothing that is necessary for us to know about Christ and his salvation is missing or misleading. It's all there in the Word of God if we would but read it in faith and submission. Two, by drawing men and women into a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit gently works on people's hearts and minds. He gives them understanding so that they understand spiritual things and so that they will be willing to place their trust in Jesus Christ and accept him as their leader and redeemer. 3, by reproducing Christ's character in us, he thus brings to life Christ-like virtues in our lives, and we just read about the fruit of the Spirit. Through the blood of Jesus, we are given victory over sin, compare Revelation 12:11, and the Holy Spirit enables us to walk in faithfulness to God's commandments. And then 4, finally, by enabling us to live a Christ-like, selfless, and loving life of service to others, he calls men and women into specific lines of work for God and enables us to reach out to others in the attractive spirit of Christ. That's a part of our Adult Sabbath School Bible Study Guide for Thursday, January 12. So in all those things, we see the Holy Spirit doing what?
Lifting up Christ.
Is he trying to exalt himself?
No.
Not at all. He's trying to lift up Christ, to make Christ prominent before us and in our thinking. So, is it possible that by lifting up Christ, he's also glorifying the Father?
Jesus said that if you've seen me, you've seen the Father.
Okay. How do we explain Matthew 5, verse 16? In the same way, your light must shine before people so that they will see the good things you do and praise your Father in heaven. How does that work?
It's all part of God's kingdom. Mm-hmm. So if somebody from our country goes over and does good deeds somewhere, and they are, you know, like the Peace Corps did, you know, mm-hmm. it reflects positively on our country. If we do good things in God's name, in Christ's name, then it glorifies him.
Okay.
They associate us with him.
Well, think of your own personal experience. Can you identify times when the Holy Spirit was active in your own life? Well, here's Ellen White's comments about that. While the wind is itself invisible, it produces effects that are seen and felt. So the work of the Spirit upon the soul will reveal itself in every act of him who has felt its saving power. When the Spirit of God takes possession of the heart, it transforms the life. Sinful thoughts are put away, evil deeds are renounced, love, humility, and peace take the place of anger, envy, and strife. Joy takes the place of sadness, and the countenance reflects the light of heaven. Star of Ages 173, paragraph 1. Well, so we constantly need to remember that the work of the Holy Spirit is not a once-in-a-lifetime event. Guess what that's talking about?
Work of a lifetime.
Have you ever heard of people who say, once saved, always saved?
Or I remember when I was young, somebody saying that God grows us up until we're mature and then we can act on our own. And I don't think that's the nature of things at all. We are always dependent on God. It's because we were separated from him that we're in this mess.
The Holy Spirit needs to work with us every day. His work is the work of a lifetime. Could we as Christians learn to work in a powerful way and finish the gospel by working behind the scenes as the Holy Spirit does? In our attempts to try to reach out to others, how can we make Jesus the center of our attention just as the Holy Spirit does? Are we good at that?
We need to realize we're earthen vessels and that the treasure is Christ.
I have unfortunately experienced some times when some preachers have come and conducted a big show and, oh boy, it's a huge big thing, and you know, people are sort of converted to the preacher instead of to Jesus. I don't think that's probably the way things should happen. So I want you to think for a moment now. Try to imagine yourself, you're a member of the Sanhedrin, and you're struggling because you've seen Jesus do some pretty amazing things in the temple. And so now you've decided, when it's nighttime, that you're going to accompany Nicodemus out to talk to Jesus. What do you think attracted Nicodemus?
He must mm-hmm. have been an act, a seeker of truth.
Okay.
He probably recognized that there was something wrong with their way of thinking when he compared it with what Jesus was saying. When Jesus said, I like the way it's given in the French version of that passage, here you are a sacrificer in Israel. In other words, one who sacrifices animals. And you don't know what the new birth is.
Yeah.
What you're doing there is really teaching people that sin kills. Mm-hmm. You're teaching them that if you go there, it's because you lack love. And Jesus is trying to tell Nicodemus, you are teaching something you don't even know what it means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, we all know that baptism means death and resurrection, right? Mm-hmm. Well, the same was true here with the message that Jesus was trying to convey to Nicodemus.
Nicodemus, remember, is among the 70 most revered people in the nation. He was a member of what would be the Congress of those days, a very respected, wealthy member of Congress. And what's he doing here? He's going to the other side of the tracks, to a despised place, to someone who comes from a despised place, to ask questions. I mean, think about it. So what did he do about it? Did he rush out and tell everybody about what he had learned that night?
I would guess he took some time to really think that through.
Well, almost 3 years went by, and we have no record of him doing virtually anything. But he was doing things. What was he doing?
Working behind the scenes.
Working behind the scenes, and how did he do that?
He raised questions when they tried to have a trial by night, or I could
even earlier wrong the, they would discussions would come up about Jesus, and he would raise questions that they couldn't deal with. Mm-hmm. Finally, Ellen White says when they had that final nighttime trial of Jesus, they didn't call him, and they didn't call Joseph of Arimathea, because they knew that these guys would raise questions that they weren't prepared to answer. Well, what was the final result of that night meeting? Remember?
I mean that night?
Oh, what was the final result of that that meeting? Downstream.
Yeah. Well, he came forward.
He came forward. When did he come forward?
At Christ's death, and asked for the body.
At Christ's death. And Joseph of Arimathea asked for the body. He was given the body. What did Nicodemus do? Provided the spices, which gave them a proper, really a royal kind of burial, and there, right in Jerusalem, and within the city precinct, just outside the wall, I guess, officially. And who was helping them? Who were the three people who actually took the body down from the cross? Well, there was
John, the
Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, and John the disciple, the beloved. And I read these words from Ellen White. After the Lord's ascension, when the disciples were scattered by persecution, Nicodemus came boldly to the front. He employed his wealth in sustaining the infant church that the Jews had expected to be blotted out at the death of Christ. In the time of peril, he who had been so cautious and questioning was firm as a rock, encouraging the faith of the disciples and furnishing means to carry forward the work of the gospel. He was scorned and persecuted by those who had paid him reverence in other days. He became poor in this world's goods, yet he faltered not in the faith which had its beginning in that night conference with Jesus. Nicodemus related to John the story of that interview, and by his pen it was recorded for the instruction of millions. The truths there taught are as important today as they were on that solemn night in the shadowy mountain when the Jewish ruler came to learn the way of life from the lowly teacher of Galilee. I am sure that we don't have any idea what a condescension that was for him to go. And I mean, I'm trying to think of, I mean, this was the first, right after the, well, at the end of, or near the end of the first Passover. So he's, how much exposure has Nicodemus had to Jesus?
Well, he had certainly heard of him, or he wouldn't have called him for a meeting at night.
Yeah.
And he was a searcher of truth, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And I was reading that John 18:37, when Jesus talking to Pilate, mm-hmm. he says, "I came to bear witness to the truth." But the next sentence is, goes something like this: "It's really for the those that are searching for truth. Truth is available to anybody." Mm-hmm. But if you have no interest in it, no desire, it has no efficacy for you.
So something, I mean, clearly the work of Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit must have really been working with him.
But how does that work? I mean, is it the Holy Spirit going to violate the choice on the part of the individual, or does it gently present itself in such a way that you can choose or choose not to choose, so to speak, but you're making a choice for or against.
Okay, I'm going to ask you another question. Nicodemus knew that it was possible that he would be discovered. What do you think he would have said to the Sanhedrin if he had been discovered that first night?
Is this sanctified speculation on our part?
Well, yeah, but I mean, we need to put ourselves into these stories. We need to
think about
that's
what the stories are for, aren't they?
I mean, when he's walking through the city, hoping nobody will see him, heading for where he thinks he's going to find Jesus, you don't think he's asking himself, okay, what am I going to say? What am I going to say?
He might have said, I was going to prove that this guy is wrong.
Okay.
Get some evidence.
Yeah.
Undercover evidence.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we've got to remember that the time they spent together was really a short period of time, if we read the text as we have it, or it could have been much longer, and Nicodemus got a lot more from Jesus than what we have recorded in Scripture.
Yeah. It was still a very brief time that he actually had direct contact with Jesus. I mean, a few days maximum, but he must have hung around listening to Jesus in the temple, because Jesus obviously came to the temple and spoke to the crowds. And probably Nicodemus said, well, I need to make sure that everything is under control here. I better go here. You know, sort of monitor the situation, you know. But while we recognize that the Holy Spirit was present in creating that gorgeous and beautiful world, back in the beginning, he is just as active today in recreating lives after the nature of God. Does it take more creative power to make something new or to repair it when it has been damaged? What happens if you get a minor accident in your car? It doesn't take very much of an accident, and they're going to say, throw away the old part, put on a brand new part. Why is that?
Cheaper.
It's cheaper than trying to work out all the details and, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Probably wouldn't have been when everything was handmade, but now that we mass produce these things, it's easier to have the machines do it than for somebody to come in there and hand do it.
So how, and Jim, you suggested this earlier, how does the Holy Spirit actually intend for us to work with him? Are we supposed to, if everything works perfectly, are we supposed to be puppets?
No, we've been granted individuality, but the Creator is love, and he could only create intelligent creatures that have the capacity to make a choice.
And now, that's the key, the choice. Otherwise, we would walk after the flesh.
Yeah.
It's only through the presence of the Holy Spirit that we have a choice, and we can choose to walk after the Spirit and thus after life.
I'm going to take you to a translation of the Bible that includes the Greek. We don't need to worry about the Greek right now, but it's interesting to notice here, but this is Galatians 5, verse 23, 22 and 23, but the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit is singular.
Yes.
Is, why is this? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now the last part of that is self-control, and the Greek word, that's exactly what it means. Enkrateia means control within yourself, self-control.
So that doesn't, that imply, or that says that isn't the whole, an entity is not going to be controlling you. It's you yourself, when you've learned the truth about God, you can exercise self-control.
So why is that so absolutely essential? I'm thinking down the line.
Well, ultimately, God is not going to be have prisons and prison guards and prison wardens and so forth. Everybody's going to admire the Creator.
In the new kingdom, in the new heaven and new earth, everybody's going to be perfectly free.
Yeah, and that's what what we call the Ten Commandments, that is a description of the way all intelligent creatures will conduct themselves for eternity without an authority figure standing over them with a bullwhip ready to keep them back in line.
So, basically, yeah.
Yeah, on the other hand, we have to remember there was no punctuation. Mm-hmm. The fruit of the Spirit is love. All the rest of these other words are what happens when you have love.
Yeah.
There you go.
They all fit together.
Yeah, they do.
That's why it's a singular fruit.
With slices in it, if you want.
you can't have someone who says, let's see, I'll have love and patience and kindness, but I don't want those other things.
Well, I ask God to control me. Yeah. You know, I let the Spirit control me. It doesn't work that way. Because if it does, then you don't have any responsibility. You don't have self-control.
So this is another example of the Spirit allowing us freedom and working behind the scenes. He provides the evidence. He says, please look at this. Please evaluate it for yourself. Make your own choices, but please make the right choices.
So all through the Old Testament, when they make the wrong choices, it says you don't listen.
Yeah.
You're not taking instruction. And the ultimate demonstration, the ultimate teaching was the cross. What we call the cross is Jesus came and demonstrated what the Father was like.
It's the message of the cross.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not the killing.
How does that actually work? How do we give the Holy Spirit an opportunity to work in our lives and yet retain freedom?
Because we have a choice.
Okay.
But it's by beholding Christ, and in Christ, the light of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, and it's through the Spirit that we behold all these things, so that we're all one. But it's the choice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have a choice to walk after the flesh or walk after the Spirit.
Good.
Yeah. I think we have to remember that freedom has got two faces. One is a destructive side of freedom, and we're all perfectly capable of being destructive with our freedom. Mm-hmm. The other is the positive or constructive, loving side of freedom. If you have love, how can you be on the destructive side of freedom?
Mm-hmm.
And what God and the Spirit of God is all about is teaching us what that love is that will keep us on the productive, constructive, loving side of freedom as opposed to the other side.
We have the opportunity to open God's Word and let the Holy Spirit speak to us through God's Word. That opportunity the Holy Spirit takes advantage of as He transforms us, as He changes us. By beholding, we become changed. We can't make the changes in our mind. The Holy Spirit can do that, but we have the choice to say, no, I don't want it, or yes, I want it. Thus, our freedom is exercised in allowing the Holy Spirit to do what needs to be done. We can't sort of make ourselves fit for the kingdom of heaven. We just don't have that power. But the Holy Spirit does have that power, but we have the power to keep Him out.
We can turn around, mm-hmm. We can change direction, and that's on our own. Mm-hmm. And that's called, we call repentance.
And conversion.
Which is thinking differently.
Yeah.
Thinking in terms of love instead of thinking in terms of self-service or serving self.
A simple illustration might be if you had a heater over here and you were cold, you choose to get close to the heater. You're not, you say, well, I'm warming myself, but really it's the heater warming me.
Exactly.
You know? But I have chosen to come close, in close proximity, in order to get warmed.
So we get to know God by giving the Holy Spirit an opportunity to bring the truth into our lives. And I mean, I don't know how to say that any better than that. That's part of the inspiration process that we talked about last week. So there's probably no clearer contrast in the Bible between these verses I just read to you, the works of the devil and the works of the Spirit. And which side would you like to find yourself? I mean, if you put it just like that, who would want to choose the devil's side? So how do we allow him to do it? We've talked about that. There is certainly no hesitation on God's part. He's not the one that keeps us from moving forward and getting closer to the end. We're the ones that are delaying the second coming. We must be willing to sacrifice our pride, our selfishness, our lust, our desire for self-exaltation. We must be willing to give up our natural desires. So we're asked to read or to look at Ezekiel 37. We mentioned it earlier, but just look at that chapter very quickly. I felt the powerful presence of the Lord, and His Spirit took me and set me down in a valley where the ground was covered with bones. He led me all around the valley, and I could see that there were very many bones and that they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal man, can these bones come back to life?" I replied, "Sovereign Lord, only you can answer that." He said, "Prophesy to the bones." Wouldn't that seem like a hopeless case? "Tell these dry bones to listen to the word of the Lord. Tell them that I, the sovereign Lord, am saying to them, I'm going to put breath into you and bring you back to life. I will give you sinews and muscles and cover you with skin. I will put breath into you and bring you back to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I had been told. While I was speaking, I heard a rattling noise, and the bones began to join together. While I watched, the bones were covered with sinews and muscles, and then with skin, but there was no breath in the bones. God said to me, "Mortal man, prophesy to the wind." Of course, wind is another word for what?
Spirit.
Spirit. "Tell the wind or the spirit that the sovereign Lord commands it to come from every direction to breathe into these dead bodies and bring them back to life." And so he goes on telling that's exactly what happened. Where was Ezekiel when that happened? You remember?
In the valley of the dry bones.
Yeah. I'm thinking it is not in vision, but in reality. Where was he?
Well, he'd be in Babylon.
He was a prisoner. He was a
vicinity.
Yeah, he was in the vicinity of Babylon, a prisoner, and everything seemed totally hopeless. So what's God trying to say to him? With my kind of power available, nothing is hopeless, not even dry bones. Okay? So what are we supposed to learn from this brief illustration?
Could the bones have been drier than they were when Jesus came to this world?
Yeah, right. Exactly.
The whited sepulchers?
We need to appreciate the fact, I'm reading from Ellen White, that God is our efficiency. We do not remember this, and therefore we lose much in religious experience. We work ourselves in place of being worked by the Holy Spirit's power. Testimonies to Southern Africa, page 81, paragraph 8.
Does truth have power?
Sure.
It sounds formative power.
Right. But I mean, wouldn't we? I don't want to get off on too much of a tangent now. We'll work on it in the future. But that's the idea. Truth is available. And if you don't have an affinity for it, if you don't have an appreciation for it yet, don't have a desire, if you're satisfied where you're going, it doesn't have any effect on you.
Yeah. Well, think about how many preachers you've heard on TV and other places like that. If the Holy Spirit would just come down and would do what we want Him to do, what are they saying? If we could just use the Holy Spirit to do what we want to do.
They're dictating what God should do.
It's what Simon wanted to do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the Holy Spirit can come down. He can be active in making the changes necessary in our lives to prepare us for the second coming. We need to spend more time with the Word. That would be the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ, the Bible. The Holy Spirit, under those circumstances, can transform us by beholding as we learn about God. We will see the beauty of Jesus and want to be more like Him. Think of all the conflicts which take place in our world today, from full-scale wars to conflicts within the church itself. Nearly all earthly conflicts, probably all, but I put nearly all, arise because one or more persons is or are motivated by satanic ideas, greed, selfishness, hatred, pride. I mean, we could go on and on. Try to imagine how different things would be if all Christians allowed their lives to be guided by the Holy Spirit and the fruit of the Holy Spirit. How different would things be? What could we do to make that possible? Shouldn't we spend more time reading the Bible and contemplating the Word of God? Isn't that God's guide for our lives? Isn't that His intention? We are so busy, and the devil is so good at convincing us, well, I've got to do this right now, and I'm too busy doing that, and I can delay. I'll get back to the Spirit when there's time, right? Well, the more we recognize the beauty of Christ, the more we will be attracted to Him. The better we understand God's side in the great controversy, the clearer it will be to us why God's plan for the universe and for our lives is the only possible way to live in a universe full of love and peace. Just imagine what it would be like to live in a universe controlled by satanic principles. Everyone is striving for the supremacy. Everyone's trying to one-up themselves over everybody else. It just would be, it would self-destruct.
Right, chaos.
But in the universe, the way God wants it to be, there's love and peace, and everybody is looking out how they can serve others, how they can represent God by the love and the peace that God intends. What do you think? Are we ready to let the Holy Spirit remake our lives? That's up to you. It's up to us. God is calling on us to do it. Our kind and loving Father, what a privilege it is to open Your Word and to think of these elevating, lofty thoughts about You and about Your Son and about Your partner, the Holy Spirit. May we represent You correctly. As we've tried to do this evening in this series of lessons, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.